So this is Wahid Karzai. Today we are presenting ACTA Thoracic Webinar, Recent Advances in Lung Isolation Techniques. We will acquaint you with common methods which are used successfully in our practice in large thoracic centers. We'll also update you on new developments in this area. By the end of the webinar, you'll be able to define indications and relative contraindications on using double lumen tubes or bronchial blockers. We will show you how to integrate video-assisted intubation and video-assisted lung isolation techniques in your practice. We will show you how to make appropriate decisions regarding lung isolation and one lung ventilation with anticipated or unanticipated difficult airway, and we'll discuss airway management in very special case of a lung transplantation. As we're talking about airway management, we'll not only have a theoretical discussion, we'll provide you with practical advice on how you can integrate this in your daily practice. Hi again, and it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Jo Morice. Dr. Jo Morice is a cardiothoracic anesthesiologist with special interest in thoracic anesthesia and one lung ventilation. And within airway management, he has done a lot of work in bronchial blockers. And he works at the Radboud University Medical Center.
Thank you, Wahid, for your nice
And he's going to
introduction.
talk about the friendly bronchial blockers. So, Jo.
Thank you, Wahid, for your nice introduction. Welcome all in this little room at our department. It's great to speak to so many people. I have no disclosures. On this slide, you see a sanatorium and a lung clinic that was built more than 100 years ago. At that time, lung surgeons operated without the use of double lumen tubes or bronchial blockers. They used their hands to push away the lung. Only in cases where pus or blood could contaminate the underlying lung, the red rubber double lumen tube was placed. For many decades, double lumen tubes were used for one lung ventilation. Until now, they are considered as gold standard. Bronchial blockers were first introduced in 1936 by McGill, but they never gained wide acceptance in lung surgery. Meanwhile, a lot has been changed. In the last 10 years, there's increased interest in bronchial blockers. Patients changed. Today, the secretions are much less of a problem. Incidents of bronchiectasis, disease, lung abscesses, empyema and tuberculosis are far lower. Antibiotics and lung function optimization reduced the amount of secretions. Anesthesiologists changed. Fiber optic bronchoscopes were developed in the 1950s, and nowadays we can use high-quality video bronchoscopes where almost every detail of the airway can be made visible. Also, surgeons changed. Less invasive techniques require a better quality of lung collapse, simply because the surgeon cannot help to empty the lung manually. Bronchial blockers have changed. Modern blockers appeared in the last 30 years. The Fogarty embolectomy catheter is the oldest one and still in use for pediatric cases and also for selective lobe blockade. It's available in various sizes and have only a single channel to fill the balloon. Several modern bronchus blockers appeared on the market, each of them pretending unique properties. The most frequently used blockers are on this slide. The UniBlocker was first on the market as an endotracheal tube with an integrated channel for the blocker. Later the blocker was sold loose from a tube and could be introduced through the lumen of the endotracheal tube. The other frequently used blockers are the Arn blocker, the Rush EZ blocker, and the Cohen blocker. Properties of the most frequent used blockers are on this slide. Most blockers are low pressure and high volume balloons. Except for the Fogarty and the Easy Blocker, they are high pressure and low volume. There is also a variation in the diameter of the internal channels. The Easy Blocker has the smallest channels, with just only 1.7 millimeters to serve as a suction channel. And some experts question the possibility to apply suction with it. Blockers differ mostly in their guiding mechanism. Fogarty has none, except that one can vent the tip manually. The Uni blocker has a pre-shaped tip. The arm is guided with a wire that is attached to the tip of a bronchoscope. And the Easy blocker is positioned with a bifurcation on the carina, and then one can choose which balloon is inflated. The Cohen blocker has a steering wheel where you can flex the tip. This Fogarty and Easy blockers have high pressure balloons. When, for example, the Easy blocker is filled with 8 mLs of air, that's a volume that is routinely used, the pressure in the balloon exceeds 100 centimeters of water. Is this a drawback? I don't think so. To have an occlusion of the bronchus, the balloon must have contact with the bronchial wall, and one should look precisely with the bronchoscope to the balloon during its inflation. If the wall of the bronchus is not yet touched, the pressure on the mucosa is still zero, and mucosal ischemia is not expected. Once the wall is touched, you can see a ring of mucus and some pearls reflecting the light. When using high pressure balloons, you do not need to measure intra-balloon pressure, but use visual inspection. Low pressure balloons, you do have to measure the pressure and must keep it under 30 centimeters of water. On the right, you can see the cuff of a not very deeply positioned Blumen tube. Notice that you can see only a quarter of the cuff, whereas a balloon of a blocker can be seen around. Volume needed to fill a large bronchus is also large. Some of our patients have wide mainstem bronchi, and diameters sometimes exceeds 40 or 50 millimeters. In such a case, the so-called low-pressure balloons must be inflated beyond manufacturer's advice, and the low pressure will become a high-pressure balloon. And the same applies to double lumen tubes, especially when a too small tube was chosen. Now we go to the video player. Just a little. Okay, here you see Easy blocker resting with its bifurcation on the carina, and now the left yellow leg is inflated, and just until you see the rim of mucus and some pearls to show that there is contact with the wall. Now the other side is up, and the bronchus intermedius is now inflated, and you see here that he's popping out. So it's inflated too much, and now it's resting in the opening on the right side, just before the right upper lobe. Now we are unsure about the right volume, so we deflate this side. Now we will pull back some millimeters the Easy blocker, so that the balloon will position itself just in front of the opening of the right upper lobe. Now you see nice rim of mucus and some pearls. So this one is good. Now I'm going back to this side. An advantage of a blocker is that it is usually advanced through the lumen of an endotracheal tube. The balloon tubes are stiff and bulky, and they often are difficult to put in place, especially in the presence of a difficult airway. A single lumen tube is easier to place, and as a direct consequence, the blockers cause less injury to the airway. I will show you some evidence later. Another advantage is that there is no need to replace the tube in a patient already intubated, or when a tracheostoma is present, or when postoperative ventilation is needed. A blocker is also easier to size than a double-lumen tube. For adults, there is one size for the blocker, and for double-lumen tubes, one has to choose between at least four sizes. The final volume must be set by visual inspection during bronchoscopy, as already shown. And if indicated, selective lobar collapse is only possible with the blocker. Main disadvantage of a block is that the underlying lung is unprotected. Secretions, pus or blood could contaminate the lung and possibly lead to profound desaturation. In that case, double-lumen tubes are the first choice. Another disadvantage is the increased costs of the blocker. Blockers are up to twice as expensive than double-lumen tubes. The need for bronchoscopy increases further the costs, but there is wide agreement among experts that the bronchoscopy should be done in all cases. Some experts advocate that blockers take more time to place, are more prone to dislodgement, and that the time to deflate a lung takes more time. In the last 20 years, several researchers investigated these issues, and so we can look if there is scientific evidence for this. In a meta-analysis, Plate and Smith tried to summarize the findings of 13 randomized controlled trials. They published their results in 2015, and after that year, some other studies were published also. I will mention them too. First, the time to place. The time to place double-lumen tubes compared to blockers were investigated here in that randomized controlled trial. They found that double-lumen tubes were placed 51 seconds faster than the blockers. Although statistically significant, this small difference is clinically not important if you consider the length of the operation. Each of these studies has rather small sample sizes, and thus these randomized controlled trials fail to demonstrate infrequent but clinically important differences. For example, the double-lumen tubes are sometimes difficult to place, and the time needed to placement will quickly increase. The presence of a difficult airway is often an exclusion criterion in these studies, and sometimes patients were excluded because of failed intubation with a double-lumen tube or a blocker. As can be seen in the table, great variation in time to placement among studies can be noticed. This is because start and end points differ much between studies. Frequency of malposition was higher in the blocker group. Again, these studies in this meta-analysis differ substantially in their methods. This analysis brings us not much further. It's better to look at certain time points. Initial malposition are generally quickly resolved using a bronchoscope. More interesting is the incidence of dislocation after turning into the lateral decubitus or during surgery. Several studies show that blockers dislocate more than the double-lumen tubes. Indeed, the double-lumen tubes are more stiff and wide than the rather floppy and thin blocker. Between the types of blockers, it looks like that the arm blocker dislocates more frequently than the Cohen or the Fuji blocker. and that the easy blocker dislocates less than the coherent blocker. The time of collapse is indeed a major component of the success of one-lung ventilation. Data from different studies show conflicting results. Early studies using one-lung ventilation started with inflation of the balloon and then wait for collapse, with or without suction through the narrow lumen of the blocker. This results in long deflation times compared to the balloon tubes. In such a situation, the size of the internal channel is important.